Okay, hiya. My name's Pat Randle, and we are at the Whittington Press, where I am going to talk you through what is like our latest publication called 2020 Vision. And this is a kind of collaboration with the Society of Wood Engravers. It's the centenary of the Society this year, and to celebrate that, we've made this book, which really is a celebration of kind of current engravers of today. And the kind of the thought behind the idea for the book is that the 20 engravers chosen talk about their inspiration, their artistic inspiration in terms of engraving. And thankfully, most of them have chosen engravers as their kind of inspiration. So the way that it works is that each engraver has been asked to make an engraving to go alongside their inspiration. This on the left here, on the right, sorry, is Neil Bousfield, and on the left is Paul Nash. And you can kind of see a symmetry between behind why that person has chosen and been inspired by that previous engraver. This is obviously Buick on the left, and this is Ian Stevens. And then this is Wadsworth and Anne Desmet. And so you get a double page spread of the engravings next to each other side by side. And what the current engraver has done is write a short piece, about 200 or 300 words, about why they've chosen that person as their inspiration. So if I go back a couple. So here you've got Neil Bousfield talking about why Paul Nash is, why he's inspired by Paul Nash. And then at the end of the four page spread, you get a short kind of biography on both the artists. And we've been working, I should say we, like there's an amazing girl who works with me called Anna Parker. And we started work on this in about August last year. She started to print the engravings. And it's been a real tricky job to print, because a lot of the blocks that we're printing from are, you know, getting on for 100 years old. And so the wood tends to warp and disintegrate over time, and so it needs very careful mate ready. And Anna is a brilliant printer of wood engraving. She takes just enough time you know, to get the block spot on, but she's not so slow that we're able to get the book done in time for 2020, which would have been a bit of a problem if we hadn't. This is a quite a good example of one that's a bit knackered. So this is Gertrude Hermes, quite an iconic engraving of Stonehenge. And you can see there's like this really fine dot detail in the black areas. And these are the things that are really tricky to print, because to get that area black, but to get those holes not filling in, takes a lot of concentration of overlay of the packing. And of you know, you're continuously wiping away the block and wiping out the block to keep that detail there. And that's obviously John Lawrence, who knew Gertrude Hermes. So that one's actually a really nice. That one's actually a really nice narrative there about how he was inspired by Gertrude when she was teaching him how he used to drink whiskey together. So the book carries on like that. Anna printed all the blocks on the proofing press, and then I ran the text through on a Heidelberg cylinder press. So like, whereas the blocks took about 8 or 9 months to print, the edition is 450 we were running to. And you know, she was printing those on a cylinder hand press. And really it was taking her about three or four days to print each run, whereas when we get to the Heidelberg stage, it's much quicker. And the reason that we print the the blocks on a cylinder press is because you cannot really get the level of control that you need on a Heidelberg that you can on a cylinder press. On the Heidelberg, for example, you cannot interleave the sheets. They come bam, 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 bam through the back of the machine. And then you get the set off with the inks and so on. Whereas with a text, you don't get those problems, and that speeds up the whole process. And it makes the long runs, like going to that length, possible, which probably, you know, it would have added another 9 or 10 months onto the job if that had been done for a cylinder machine. Just gonna find another interesting one. This is someone with a slightly different style called Richard Wagner, who's a Californian wood engraver. And he chose, annoyingly, he chose Robert Motherwell. So obviously we don't have access to a Robert Motherwell wood engraver. Actually, I don't even know if he did wood engravings. But occasionally we get these digital tip-ins. I'll show you one more. Which I like. This is Abigail Rora on the right hand side and Leonard Baskin. Now Abigail, she engraves into something called resin grave, which is like, it's the kind of thing that you make your tabletop surface out of, like it's a really hard plastic, and actually it's much more difficult to print on. It doesn't receive the ink so well, so we find we have to put more ink on than we would do normally with the wood. And yeah, that was a real tricky one to print. But so the book continues. It's introduced with a narrative, an introduction by Nigel Hamway, who actually owns many of the blocks in here. He's a big collector of wood engravings. And then there's a short text by myself as well about the printing of the blocks and the printing of the book. And it's all edited by Pete Lawrence, who is in the society, and he's been a massive help to get this off the ground. And the way we like to do things with the editioning, so this is the regular book, of which there are 290 copies. And alongside that, we will do 50 what we call special copies, 30 of which are bound in what's called a quarter leather binding. So you get the leather spine there, and they are accompanied by a portfolio of prints here. I'll open this up the wrong way. So you get a nice folder with all your prints in there, together with the book, and they go in a slipcase. And then for the really, really ultra serious collectors, we do what's called a deluxe edition. And this really, although the bulk of the book is the same, it's an excuse for the binder as much as anything else to flex his muscle. So you get three elements. I don't know if I can show this very well, but you get three elements of this of this cylinder box. This here is the portfolio of prints. This here is a second book, which is called The Collector's Cut. And this is a series of 11 engravings. Some of the kind of iconic engravings of the last 100 years, which were not chosen by people in the book, and we had access to them. So it's really an excuse to give them an airing, really, to get them printed and included in the book. It was just a shame, really, that they weren't chosen. We should have made some of the people choose some of these engravings. Perhaps in a minute, actually. This is blank at the moment because this is a dummy back from the binder, and this is what we do before we start work on a book. Really, we will get a blank pages bound up just so we get the kind of feel and structure of the book and get to know what it's going to look like as a block, as an item. And this really is where the binder Roger Gretsch gets an excuse to flex his muscles. So this is the binding of the special 2020, and what he's done is an inlay design for us here. And that inlay design is based on, it's Roger's design, and he based it loosely on the end of an engraving tool here. This is a Sir Dominic's press book on wood engraving, and he's, I think, yeah, he's kind of taken a rift off that engraver there. But I think what he's done is incredible, really. These thin engrave lines are very difficult to do. Then there's a couple of extra things in here. This paper here, one of the artists in the book is Henry Moore, somebody chose. And this paper, the end paper, is watermarked with Henry Moore's, I don't know if you'll be able to see that. Well, not up to the light. Yeah, perhaps roughly you can see it. So that is Henry Moore's watermark, and we were lucky enough to find 50 sheets of paper that Henry Moore had watermarked for a project that he did for the Petersburg Press. That was it's actually really crappy paper to print on, so it works really nicely for an MP. So there's a few kind of all the extra trimmings we can find. We lavish into that special copy. And this here today, I've just finished printing the collector's cut. So this is how the set of sheets is going to look. So you get, I don't know how interesting this is going to be. You get four pages of text like so. Contents page. This is all looking very crappy, but it's just for my reference of where things go. Hold on a minute. Yeah, this is better. Right. So this is a set of blank sheets before they go to the binder. I've got to do the second colour on this, so you're going to get a title in there in colour. And like so, this is the block of the book. This is the text pages, which go like so, all in 14 point perpetua still. And then there's a colour engraving going there. And then we get into the engravings in the book. This is John Farley, Passion Flower, it's called. And you get just one double page spread per engraver in this book. This is Pete Lawrence's Transform. And this here is Hilary Painter's In Exile, it's called, which is a quite amazing block. And what I've done with this book is printed on, it's a Japanese paper called Sonomi Senka. Very thin, it's only about 50 gram. And it's got a rough and a smooth side. So we couldn't really print the engravings on the rough side. You just get all the tram lines and the paper markings showing through the engravings. But actually on the other side, it's really smooth and it's a really beautiful paper to print on. And I think we're using something, is that called a French fold, where the tops aren't cut of this paper. So when we've only printed on one side of the sheet, which is always nice for a printer, because if you get set off on the other side, no one's going to know. And the way it works is when you come to fold these pages, you're in effect folding two pages at a time. But I don't think it matters, you know, when you come to look at this book, your hand naturally picks two pages up. It's a kind of new style. I've never tried that style of binding before, but I think it's going to work, and it makes it something completely different to the regular book, which is what we were trying to do. So that's the book. Of other bits and pieces I've got here. This is a prospectus. So this book was meant to be launched at a fair at the end of March, which was cancelled. And you know, that was a problem. But what we've done is create a prospectus. So title page of the book, and then inside you've got a double page spread of the book. This is just a run-on four page section from the book, like we were looking at earlier. And then on the back of there, we have the edition details of the book. So an intro about how it came about, and then all of the pricings and order details are here. And we even printed an envelope, or got an envelope made. We printed the paper and stuck it to a board and sent these out. And actually, it's been pretty well received. You know, it really, in a way, it's better than going to a fair, I've started to realise. Well, it has been for this time span, because obviously people aren't going about, and I think people have been really, it's been well received when people receive this in the post. So that's that. And the other thing I was going to show you, so I mean, this is late, this book, I can't deny that. One person who will remain nameless was so bored waiting for us to get ready with this book that he's engraved us a coronavirus. So this is engraved from the engraving of a piece of olive tree, I think. And I'm slowly working out how to incorporate it into like a little, what do you call it? Like a little flyer to put in the front of the book, really. So here we have a narrative to apologise for the book being late. A bit of blurb about the next book, Peter Allen's book, and then the coronavirus is going to sit up there, something like that. I think. Haven't quite worked that one out yet, but that's going to be an insert into the next book. It's always good to send out a book with the details of the next one afterwards, in case people. In case people like it, and they might be tempted to go for the next one too. But this guy, he said, please, can you get this somewhere in the book, in my copy, to make it special? So what we've done is, I've just done him one copy with it on the half, that's the half title page there. The regular book, it opens up. It's funny design, actually. We've got two half title pages, which is slightly unusual, but it gave us an excuse to get, that's the half title, and I just wanted to get that block in there somewhere, which is the block used for the pattern on the repeat pattern on the design. And then you go from there to the title page. So that nice coronavirus sits on the half title there. And yeah, I think that's it. I can't think of anything else to say. Have you got any questions, or can I add anything to anything? No? Okay. See you later.